gods of the theatre, smile on us. You who sit up there stern in judgment, smile on us. You who look down on actors, and who doesn't, bless this yearly festival and smile on us. We offer you song and dance.
Welcome to Thespis in the Green Room. It's Bruce and Melanie here.
Hello, hello.
Season 2, episode 3.
Yes. A third has finally arrived.
There you go. Nice to be here.
It's nice to be here.
Well, we say here, people are going, where are we here? Where are you? I'm really meaning it's nice to be here with you and you know, chit-chatting and back doing the show because we've had a little bit of a hiatus. So this is kind of nice to get together and catch up, of course. And today we're coming from the lobby of the theater at the beautiful Chapman Cultural Center in downtown Spartanburg, which is, it's really a great little space.
It is. It's amazing.
Yeah. I had the privilege of a couple shows here and, you know, it's just, it's always come to watch shows here. It's just great. It's a beautiful little space.
It is. Yeah. Somebody described it once as a mini Lincoln Center.
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah. And it does kind of have that feel on the outside, it even does. A little bit in the inside, I guess, and how it's set up. But yeah, it has that. Definitely has that look.
It's those three buildings making up the campus,
right?
And the way they're positioned.
That's cool.
It's kind of Lincoln Center-esque.
Yeah, very nice. And today we're going to steal a few moments with Ahsha Daniels, who is directing at the Spartanburg Little Theatre, Terms of Endearment.
Yes. Yeah.
Another in their tech week this week, so it's been a feat kind of getting that organized, because as you get closer, as you know, it's always hard to fit anything in.
There's no time. But we did manage to nail down a few minutes, so we're going to chat with her.
Yeah, and a little bit about Ahsha. So Ahsha is making her directorial debut here at Spartanburg Little Theatre. She was previously seen on stage here in Hairspray. That was back in 2014. She was Dynamite, so she does some singing too.
Yes, she does.
And recently she directed the Spartanburg Youth Theater's Miss Nelson is Missing. She holds a bachelor's in communications with a theater focus from the University of South Carolina Upstate. Ahsha spent the last 4 years living in Atlanta, Georgia, where she completed the Horizon Theater Company's 2015 to 2016 acting apprenticeship program.
Yes.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Yeah.
But now she's back. She's back in the Upstate. She's
back here.
And she's fully engaged in our thriving theater community in the Upstate.
Yes. And we have a lot going on.
Yeah, so. We absolutely do. Absolutely do.
I know Atlanta was very exciting for her and she learned a lot. But it's also, you know, it's a big city.
Yeah.
So there's all that craziness that goes with
being the big city.
So,
well, it's nice she can bring what she's experienced and learned and the skills that she's honed, bring them back here and share them with us.
Yeah, we're excited to have her back.
Absolutely.
Very excited. So, Bruce, so why don't we just get right into it?
You got it. Sounds good.
Life's ducky, balmy weather. We're lucky, we're together. We're a pair, remarkably mated. Must be related. We can't bear to be separated. We share everything. Two songbirds, zero fiction. No strong words, dainty diction. Harmony is what we always sing. We're so happy we share everything.
Ahsha, welcome to the Green Room.
Yay!
Yeah! Today it's really kind of a blue room, but you know, we say the green room because that's what the show is called, you know, but anyway, welcome. It's so nice to sit down and chat with you.
Yes. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So tell us a little bit about how you got started in theater. Do you remember your first show?
Ooh, my first show.
You said ooh.
Because I'm thinking about like first grade, second grade. I've been in a lot of like chorus productions. I know for sure I was in Three Little Pigs.
As a pig,
I was. I think I was Mama Pig.
Okay.
I was good.
That's a sow, just so that you know. Okay. All right, anyway, go ahead.
But I would probably say my first production that I remember vividly was in eighth grade. I was the Scarecrow in The Wizard of Oz.
Right.
And
what a great role.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think that was the moment that I was like, this is it. Mm-hmm. Like, this is exactly where I'm supposed to be, what I'm supposed to be doing.
There is definitely that bite that happens when you experience a role or just a part in a show or just any kind of aspect of theater. I think when you go, this feels so right. So it was the Scarecrow and the Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
Very good. Mm-hmm. All right. So the next question kind of was when did you decide this was the profession for you? But maybe that was then, maybe it was a different time. Tell us when you kind of decided, hey, maybe I'd like to do this for the rest of my life.
So I think that kind of came in stages, because I think it was eighth grade when I was like, oh, this is what I love. This is what I love to do. I love this feeling that I'm having. But I didn't know how to articulate that. And so from that in eighth grade was like, I just want to be famous. All through high school, that was it. I just wanted to be famous. I wasn't going to college. I was going to finish high school and go straight to LA. And my mom and dad weren't having that. I think I had to go to college I have a family full of educators, and so that was not an option. And I guess for my dad's main thing is, I just want to know your plan. Like, if you're not going to go to college, what are you going to do? And I only knew how to say, I just want to be famous and go to LA, I was going to get there. And he's like, what are you going to do for money? I mean, I'll find a job. No. You need to already have a job. You need to already have money going into that. So anyway, so I stayed here, went to USC Upstate in Spartanburg.
Right.
And I got into theater, got into the first show my freshman year, and it was Amadeus.
Oh, wow. Another great show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was awesome. And then I think from then, just taking classes and learning a little bit more really about the craft is when then I started to like melt into it. Mm-hmm. And then discover, okay, this is where I want to be. This is the path that I want to take. And was then able to articulate to my dad that this is what I want to do. And now the goal is no longer to be famous. Mm-hmm. Like, I have no desire really to be famous, you know?
It's horrible. It looks horrible.
It looks miserable. Yeah. Like, I have no desire. But it is just about doing what I love to do and how it makes me feel and making money doing it, you know? Mm-hmm. Just being able to pay my bills and, you know, not have to feel like I'm going to work all the time. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, you talked about being in a show. You're on the different end of things in this production, so you're not on stage. So tell us a little bit about when you started feeling like, I want to direct. Mm-hmm. I want to be a part of the other end of things.
I think that was also in college, just taking different classes. I had to take some intro to directing and stage management, just production side classes, focus classes. And I think maybe I did a student production that another student wrote. I can't remember exactly now. It's been a long time.
So old.
I know. So I had to direct for one of my classes, and it was really hard, and I didn't like it at all when I first did it. Like, it just, I felt, and like, I think it was more just intimidation when I got in there, that because I was an actor first,
right?
I felt like I just wanted to be acting, and so I didn't know how to tell them. I didn't know how to direct them. Right. I just knew how to say, this is how that line should be said. Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Because
I'm
just hate that.
Yeah, exactly. People hated me.
Yeah.
They hated me.
That's not a good way to go about it.
Right. Yeah.
And I think some people do make that mistake when they get into directing. They think, oh, well, I'll just make these people my puppets.
Mm-hmm.
That's not directing.
Yeah, exactly. And I just had to learn that. I had to learn how to just be a director. And I've now learned that I'm an actor's director, which is good. And
that's always a great thing.
Yeah. Like, I think actors appreciate it, and I appreciate it when I am on the other side. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important, not a must, but I do think it's important for directors to have been on the acting side at least once, so that you know what it's like, what it feels like, what the thoughts that go through your head when you're reading a script and analyzing and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, so I kind of lost my train of thought.
I'll bring you back. Okay. I was saying, when did you kind of, because you told me that you didn't like the acting or the directing side of it. So when did you fall in love with that?
So when I graduated college, I got a job directing at Upstate. and I directed 6 Degrees of Separation. Mm-hmm. Because it turns out, like, I ended up directing a couple of shows, and I was actually, eventually, I ended up being a pretty good director. And so they invited me back to do 6 Degrees. And so when I was there, just that whole process going back to upstate where I felt like it all began, and I was directing my peers, I think that helped me a lot. So it was a little bit less intimidation. And some of them were my friends, you know what I mean? So we had like a different kind of communication. I think that was when, and I had like a, not like a real connection to the show, but I knew the story and I was intrigued by the story. And so I think that also helped. But I think that was the moment at 6 Degrees is when I was like, okay, I think this is kind of where I want my path to start to lead. Mm-hmm. And I also kind of started to realize that directing might be where the money is, you know, sure, you know, right. Like, you know, just honestly thinking about like future at that sure, moment, because yeah. I was like 24 and I still did, though I didn't want to just be famous. I knew that this was what I wanted to do. And I knew that acting roles were not going to come, you know, right. Just back to back to back. And so, yeah, so I just, after 6 Degrees, I just kind of pursued directing after mm-hmm. that and started to get more jobs with directing. And then here I am. Mm-hmm.
All right. Excellent. Very good. So now you've acted and you stage managed and you've directed all over the upstate. And we, of course, we've gotten, you know, we've got a bit of a history because we worked together at Center Stage. Yeah. Very well, mm-hmm. So that's cool. And you've graduated from University of South Carolina upstate with a communications degree focused on theater. So you've directed now the Spartanburg Youth Theater and now the Spartanburg Little Theater. And you spent 4 years in Atlanta completing an apprenticeship program with Horizon Theater Company. Mm-hmm. So from all of that, because there's a lot in there, mm-hmm. what do you consider your career highlights so far?
I think one of them is directing 6 Degrees of Separation at upstate, just being able to go back. It gave me a little bit of confidence leaving college, because when I graduated, I had no idea what was next and what I was going to do. And so it gave me just some confidence that like this might be what I can do, you know, the fact that they invited me back and they That's knew my
nice,
work.
It's always nice to be invited, right?
Right. Yeah. It is. You don't have to go and ask or right. beg or anything. Yep. So, yeah. So I think that was probably a highlight. And then also like for the other students that were there, they knew me. And to be able to see me graduate and then come back mm-hmm. as a director, sure. you know what I mean? Yeah. That kind of gave them a little push. And then I worked backstage, but here at the Spartanburg Little Theater was years ago, maybe like 15 years ago, Debbie Allen came and did
The Brothers Debbie of the Allen? Night.
The Debbie Allen.
Wow.
She's still on my resume.
Oh, cool.
So she came and did Brothers of the Night here, and I was just ASM, but just to be able to be yeah. in her presence, and yeah. she's like brilliant just sitting in a chair, you know what I mean, watching. And so that was awesome, and that was pretty new into getting into theater in Spartanburg and that sort of things. I maybe was just like a sophomore, I think, in college at that time. So that was definitely a highlight. And then probably when I moved to Atlanta, though it was very hard and I doubted myself all the years that I was there, I think it, when I am now back in South Carolina, looking back at my time in Atlanta, I consider it a highlight just because of the amount of things that I learned mm-hmm. about myself and about the business. Yeah, just I feel like I came away smarter mm-hmm. and better. I'm sure you are.
I mean, it's funny. It's always hindsight's always queer. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? We look mm-hmm. back and can kind of say, oh, that's what that was all about.
Yeah.
Gee, this is what I took away, especially when you bring it to a new project mm-hmm. that you're working on, you go, ah, that's something that I gained that I can now bring to somebody else.
And, yeah.
And so you don't always see it clearly then. You mm-hmm. know? So yeah, that's excellent.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
So who are some of Ahsha Daniels' inspirations? Who do you, you know, look at or take some inspiration from or maybe some guidance from?
Whoopi Goldberg.
Hmm? Oh,
okay. I love Whoopi Goldberg.
Yeah.
And I think it started probably started with Ghost, because I'm sure that was probably the first movie I saw with her mm-hmm. in it. But then as I got older, The Color Purple. Mm-hmm. And I think just what she's done in life, and I feel like I've read a lot about other people's thoughts of her and how she's just overcome that mm-hmm. and not cared at all, you know what I mean? And she is just so authentic and unapologetically herself. Mm-hmm. And I love that about her. And to be just a Black woman that is so successful and is not afraid to, you know, speak their mind about mm-hmm. things that are happening in the world, that's just an inspiration, mm-hmm. you know, to me. Yeah. And I think I've just watched her all along, you know, in different roles and then on The View and even just her style, mm-hmm. you know, she just, I just want to be her. I want to be Whoopi. But then also, and also probably Viola Davis. And I think probably for the same reasons and more Viola Davis, because it just shows me that there's no real like time, you know what I mean? Like it happens when it happens for you. Sure. And
we have that's in our minds so often, we got to be at a certain point in a certain whatever. And yeah, you're right. We have to be patient. I think, again, sometimes hindsight for that is 2022. Mm-hmm. You know, we go, oh, that's why I needed to, where I needed to be to get to this point, to whatever.
Yeah.
So yeah, you're right.
Yeah. And just to see Black women on screen and how much people love them and can love them. And I think it just gives all girls of color, people in general, but all women of color, just some inspiration mm-hmm. and a little push.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Are there some other areas that you would like to pursue? I mean, you're conquering a lot of them and you've got a lot of experience in a lot of them, but is there some particular area that you'd like to focus more on or get more experience in the realm of theater?
I think eventually I might want to produce. Like mm-hmm. I've thought about having a theater eventually in life, like later, like maybe as my, okay, I'm good on acting, I'm done directing, you know, mm-hmm. and produce my own shows. Mm-hmm. I think I'd like to do that. But yeah, but directing and acting, I mean, I think I'm an actor first, mm-hmm. But I haven't gotten as many acting roles lately, well, for years, you know, and so, but I've been getting a lot of directing. And so I just enjoy where I am right now.
That's important.
And kind of, important. Yeah. Mm. And kind of just becoming a better director. Like even with right now, like I just feel better, you know, like mm-hmm. I feel more relaxed in what I'm doing as I've grown older. So I think I'm good right now, mm-hmm. but I do think eventually I would like to probably produce.
All right. Very good.
Yeah. Good stuff. Well, let's talk about this show that you're currently directing, yes. Terms of Endearment.
Ooh, yes.
Yes. And you're currently directing that for the Spartanburg Little Theatre here mm-hmm. in Spartanburg.
Yeah.
So what's it about? What's the show about?
It centers around a very opinionated mother and her daughter. And it's over the span of about 15 years. And it just kind of goes through their life. And they're very close. They have a very close relationship, very close bond. And they talk on the phone every day. And so it's just about a story about love and their love together and love lost and love found in old age and at a new age. And the inevitabilities of life happening. And it just kind of takes you over that over the span of about 15 years with them.
What attracted you to this production?
I watched this movie with my mom growing up.
Wow, okay.
And my mom is also an actor.
Oh, okay.
And so I guess I'm going to pause because I want to go back a little bit. So that's probably another highlight of when I was in college, I directed this show called Hallelujah Girls.
Oh, yeah.
And my mom was in it.
Oh, wow.
I got to direct my mom. She drove
up. What was that like?
She drove up. Like, I was in Spartanburg here, and I'm from Columbia. So she drove up to rehearsals every night and drove back. And it was an amazing experience. She's great, you know.
Did she take direction from her daughter?
She did. She did good. But there were some times where I'm like writing notes. And I'm like, Mama, you keep missing this entrance. but that was probably also a highlight.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I remember watching this movie with my mom. I remember her performing a scene in our living room from this show. Or from the movie. And so I don't know why that just kind of the movie stuck with me even mm-hmm. at that young age. And course, as I got older, I watched it again. And of course, it had all new meanings. But I think it was just that. It was just the connection that I had with it growing up. Mm. And I think that I have a very close relationship with my mom. And there was a time where we talked on the phone every day and multiple times a day. And I think my mom is probably Aurora. And when I told her I got the job directing this, she was like, oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. 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 I'll be Aurora. It's like, I didn't ask you to be Aurora. I'm just telling you. But like, you know, I think just that connection with it, how much my mom loves it. And, I feel like that was just like a bond that we've shared, and she may not even know that we shared that bond. But when I watch that movie and think about the movie and think about their relationship, I make the connection between my mom and Aurora and Emma.
That makes sense. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this play is based on a book and of course the famous movie, and that movie was 1983. Mm-hmm. The movie came out and it took home the Oscar that year, and it's won tons of awards for everyone involved with it. What are some of the challenges of taking on a project that's based on such popular, famous material that everybody knows?
Yeah, it is challenging because, like, I saw it that way, and so I feel like that way is the right way. Mm-hmm. And so that is just one of the main challenges. Mm-hmm. But I think going into this, the playwright Dan Gordon, he did a beautiful job with the
adaptation.
Adaptation. I don't know why I couldn't think of that word. And so that helped a lot. So mm-hmm. It's the same story, but there is like a little bit different. It just pulls out different moments that are different from the movie, which helped. Mm-hmm. But there, at the same time, the movie is a classic. And so mm-hmm. there were some things that people will remember very vividly from the movie and will expect.
That's right.
And so I tried to also kind of highlight some of those moments that, because there are some lines that are exact and that sort of thing. So I tried to stay true to that because it was done before and it was done beautifully before. And so, you know, I'm not trying to make it a whole new thing, you know. Mm-hmm. So I just kind of like gave the actors their freedom, and I didn't, if they hadn't already seen the movie, I told them don't see the movie yet, you know what I mean, in the process, because I don't want you to be Shirley MacLaine or you will never be, you know, you'll never be able to, you know, do Shirley MacLaine. You'll never be able to do Deborah Winger. So I just kind of let them have their freedom. But then the moments that I did want to keep true to the movie, I kind of just was a little bit more specific in direction and not getting them to do the same as the actors in the movie, but just to have that same intensity and have just kind of pull out the real truth in that moment, which is what I felt was happening in the movie.
Mm-hmm. I would think that's a huge challenge. I mean, to do something that is so specific and that people are going to have certain expectations.
Well, it should also be mentioned that this is the South Carolina state premiere of this stage adaptation. So that's exciting. We're the first in the state to do this script.
Is it a fairly new adaptation?
It is pretty new. Yeah.
What do you hope audiences will take away from this?
So I want the audience to just watch the show for what it is, for the story that it is, and just to like take advantage of the time that you have with each other and take advantage of the love that is around you. And to just keep going, keep pushing, to like pursue harder and love deeper and to like hold tighter, just because you just don't know. You don't know what's next. And there are inevitabilities in life that will happen. So you just want to take advantage of the time that you have, you have with each other.
It's a very good message. So what's up next for you, Ahsha? Do you have anything coming up?
What's on the horizon?
Yeah.
I do.
Oh, she can't tell.
I don't know if I can tell.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Top secret.
I will be working at another theater soon in May that is in Greenville, South Carolina.
Okay.
And I'll be assistant directing, but I won't say what it is yet because I don't know if I'm allowed to say it.
Okay. Fair enough.
All right. So, but that's coming up in May. And then I will be back here at Spartanburg Youth Theater in December doing their Christmas show.
Awesome.
Nice.
Yay.
Yeah.
Well, keep us posted on all this.
I will.
Well, I'm afraid we have to let you go because you're about to run your rehearsal.
It's tech week. It's tech week. It's the last week. forever.
Do.
It seems like, and yes, it's exhausting and all that, but it's necessary.
Yes,
so, absolutely. Yeah.
It's coming along.
Thank you so much for letting us steal some time and chat with you about this. It's great to catch up.
Yeah, looking forward to seeing it. I really am.
Yeah.
Yay. Thanks, guys. Thanks. I'm so excited.
Yay. Yeah, thanks for being here, and always good to catch up.
Of course. All of right. course.
See ya.
Don't think about you, dear one. I do nicely without you, dear one. Say that over and over, keep repeating it as the days go by.
That was fun catching up with mm-hmm. Ahsha.
I always enjoy the catch up, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
We don't get to sit down with people very often, and this really makes you do it, and mm-hmm. and it just lets you fill in the blanks after some time passed. So yes. It's really cool to do. Yeah, yes. I really enjoy that.
Yeah, and I haven't seen her in ages, so it's been...
Yeah, I guess I haven't either. I mean, yeah. I guess probably a year or so.
Right.
I mean, I knew when she came back to town, so but I really haven't had a chance to really catch up.
Right.
You know, catch her on the way and go, "Hey, how you doing? Where yeah. you been?" You know, that. Kind
That's
of
what
thing.
It's been for me. I bumped into her at a show once,
right. yeah.
You know, but we were going in to see the show, so we couldn't really catch up. So yeah. This was great.
Yeah, super.
So let me run through the information about the show.
Yeah.
So Spartanburg Little Theatre's Terms of Endearment opens this Friday at the Chapman Cultural Center in Spartanburg. It runs for 2 weekends. Friday, March 6th through Sunday, March 8th, and then Friday, March 13th through Sunday, March 15th. Friday and Saturday performances are at 8 p.m., and Sunday performances are at 3 p.m. Tickets are $20 for students, $24 for seniors, and $25 for adults. You can purchase through their website, SpartanburgLittleTheatre.com, or call the box office at 864-542-ARTS. That's 864-542-2787.
All right, excellent. And you can hear in the background a little bit, they're rehearsing, getting things going. So maybe you heard a little bit. So hopefully that draws you in, right?
The acting is in full
That's right,
swing.
That's right.
So I'll also mention, because Spartanburg Little Theatre also has their 8th annual gala coming up.
They do, and they do it upright.
They do.
Yeah,
it's really, a fun party.
Really
I've been.
A fun
party.
I haven't been myself, but I've seen the pictures, and everybody kind of raves about it, and it's always a great theme and great food. And,
yeah.
And then they present, you know, little teasers from what's coming next season.
Yeah, they have like a little mini show.
Yeah.
So I can run through that information really
Sounds
quick
good.
If anybody's interested, and you should be because it's a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
So the Spartanburg Little Theatre's 8th annual gala and season reveal is coming up this month. It's on Thursday, March 26th, again at the Chapman Cultural Center. This year's theme is A Night at Studio 54. And guests are encouraged to come in cocktail attire with a touch of disco glam.
Oh, there you go.
This sounds like fun. Be a disco ball. Go for it.
Or one of the village people.
Or one of the village people. Or Andy Warhol.
There you go.
Or any of those people. These are always fun events.
They are.
So at 6:30, things will kick off with hors d'oeuvres, drinks, dancing, and a silent auction.
Dancing too.
A little bit of dancing.
Okay.
They pitch a tent. They use the lobby.
Right.
And they also usually pitch a tent out there in the quad.
March, it should be getting beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It should be nice weather.
Yeah.
Hopefully no yeah. precipitation that
My
day.
Gosh, yeah.
But yeah, they do it upright. And you can bid on, they have assorted things for the silent auction,
uh-huh.
different, sometimes they're like adventures or tickets to shows or artwork or jewelry or all kinds of stuff that you can bid on. And of course, this mm-hmm. is a fundraiser for the little theater as well. So it's a lot of fun. And then the dancing and the hors d'oeuvres and the drinks and just socializing and having a good time. So that kicks off at 6:30. on the Thursday, March 26th. And then at 7:30, they open the house. And at 8 o'clock, you can see their little show. They have this little presentation. They usually have singers singing songs from the musical numbers.
Right.
Musical numbers from... What am I trying to say? They usually
songs from the shows.
There you go.
Shows are going to throw out there.
Yeah, right. So I mean, and last year I went, and yeah, they had musical numbers from the shows, from the musical shows they're going to do, and then they did some scenes and some little bits and pieces from the non musicals from the plays. So a lot of fun. You get a little show, and you know, there's always some jokes, and Jay's up there, the artistic director of the little theater, and he's welcoming everyone. And they also give out some awards for volunteers and just different things.
Yeah,
so cool. It's a nice little presentation. So that's a lot of fun. That's coming up March 26th. If you're interested in coming, tickets are $50 and they can be purchased through their website, SpartanburgLittleTheatre.com, or you can call 864-585-8278. And I believe that's the little theater's office. So you don't call the box office for that. Box office, you can call for show tickets.
Right.
But for the gala event, you need to talk to the little theater people, not the box office.
The little theater people?
The little theater people.
Does that mean they're little people?
No. They're fabulous people, and they do really big theater for the little theater.
Excellent. Well, that should be a great night out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It'll be fun. So check it out.
Yeah.
Then follow.
Hello there, theater people. We hope you are enjoying spending time in the green room. Want to stay updated? Like and follow Thespis in the Green Room on social media. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Thespis G. That's @ThespisG. THESPISG.
Money, 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 money.
Want to support Thespis in the Green Room? If you like what you're hearing and want to encourage us to continue conversations in the Green Room, you can become a patron of the show. Visit our Patreon page. That's Patreon, patreon.com/ThespisG, and donate today. No amount is too small, and every little bit helps. Patrons will receive special content and audio extras through our Patreon page. Check it out at patreon.com/thespisg.
Good night and thank you, whoever. We are grateful you found her a spot on the sound radio. We'll think of you.
Special thanks to Dick Stevens of Stevens Magic and Fun. He can be found on Facebook at Stevens Magic and Fun.
Thespis in the Green Room is a Courageous Crossings production. Music used in this podcast is licensed by ASCAP and BMI.
So long.
Well, Bruce, I think that's about it for us today.
I guess you're right.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to catch up as usual, Melanie.
Of course.
And we'll look forward to the next one.
Yes, indeed.
All righty.
Bye.
See ya.